That was my cold brew fridge. So you're probably wondering, Max, why do you have a fridge tied up like a hostage in the background? Why do you have a hat that says cold brew on it? And what's the deal with the plaid shirt? Oh, I have a simple answer for you. I'm a designer. I think it encompasses everything I do pretty well, whether that's like actual graphic design, photography, music, rendering, sort of everything together. I guess some people would call that a creative, but I don't like to use that. Ever since I got my first computer like a decade ago now, probably, I've been like exploring all of the digital arts. That involves using different softwares, so Photoshop, After Effects, Premiere Pro, Ableton, FL Studio, the list can go on and on. Currently studying architecture in school, and I've been on half a dozen internships at different companies, large and small. All of them have their own file systems for me. When you're working with so many different softwares and workflows, you want to make sure that you have a file system that will work for all of them. So that's the point of this video. Those are for photos, design, school, and music production. It's important when you're creating your own file standards that you don't make something that's too strict or too vague. Somewhere in the middle is best, and something that has the possibility to be adapted in the future. With all of these different softwares, they're all completely different across the board, different workflows. How would you make something that works for everything? It's one thing that's universal with all of them, and that is time. Time doesn't change. Well, it kind of does, but it's technically always there. So including dates and time in your system works super well because it works for every software, it works for every field of work. So let's get into it. Okay, so the first one I want to start with is photos, because it's the easiest by far. So the way I start all my file systems is with the year. So it makes it easy to archive old files that in a box, because that's the base of the file system. Some examples of that would be like 2020, 2021. Which it is now, which I'm still not used to. The next set of subfolders is usually the date, and then the info about what it is. That ends up looking like, if we're gonna do today, for example, 21 for 2021, and that is the first part of it. Then I'll usually put a space, and then put the info, photo shoot. My folder would look like this. Sort of consecutive folders would be 2101. It's on the same day, I'll add a dash. So the benefit of doing it like this is it's chronological. So you'll know like this is the date that we did this and there's a bit of info telling you what you did. You sort it by name, it'll sort it alphabetically, and with numbers that defaults by date. So if you sort it by name, like up or down, it'll always default to the most recent thing you've done is at the very top or the very bottom, which I find very helpful personally. And it helps inform sort of the rest of the system itself. So then inside these folders, mainly shoot raw, I'll put all of my raw files in here. So all of this like raw files will end up in there. I'll import them into Lightroom. And then in the raw folder itself, I usually put the exports from Lightroom. In my Dropbox, I have this whole thing mirrored, except it doesn't have the raw folder. The next one I want to talk about is design. So these are usually all of the commissions I do. So like before, start with the year, and inside the year folder, this is a bit different than the photography one. I usually start at the file name with last two digits of the year, and then three numbers, and then a space, and then tagged onto the back of that is the project name. So this ends up looking like 21, that's 2021. I always go 001 and then increase from there. I don't think I'll ever get 999 projects in a year. If I do, then go me. And then I'll name the project design project. And then that just keeps increasing. What I do after that, so I usually have a folder at the bottom called 99999 templates. So when I start it by name, this will always be at the bottom and out of the way of the actual commissions. And add like more folders that are like 99,000 numbers for invoices, taxes, whatever, anything that isn't a project. And inside all of these, another folder structure that looks like this. So from top to bottom, I include the numbers in this so they stay in this order and not alphabetical order, which will be different. We start out with the resources. This usually has files from the client, basically anything else that is needed for the project that I didn't create. Two is the mood board. Don't always use this one. Or three is working files. Those all are just like all the Premiere projects, Ableton projects, Photoshop files, everything goes in there. 04 is exports and 05 is finals, which is basically pretty self-explanatory. So rather than overwriting files, you just put them in there. You can see all of the previous versions. It keeps it organized. You can send all those links to the client. So I just briefly want to touch on school. It's sort of different for everyone. I'm just going to explain what I do. I have different folders for each of the semesters. If you have a co-op term, I usually do 2BC. So when you sort this by name, it all goes in order. Inside each semester folder, I have the class folder. So that's just class, a bit of info about it. But my school, we have like 493 and it is studio. We design the buildings. And then inside that folder, sort of depends on the class and how you want to organize it. But I like to use my sort of standard, and maybe what I did that day was work on the structure. So usually, specifically in Studio, where it's iterative design, I copy everything or just what's needed from the folder before into the next day one. So you can always go back and you have that version control. You can sort of do the same thing as a design folder, where if you have like resources for a class, like the syllabus or whatever. So this last one is the big one. It's kind of crazy. It's my music production and DJing organization, but I've heard from my friends that it has changed their lives. I'm gonna start out from the bottom. I'm gonna start with samples, the folder on my SSD called samples. Within this, I have folders for sample packs. I have a folder for acapellas, stuff I've bounced, instrumentals. So within each of these, they follow different file structures. Someone I want to talk about right now is the sample packs, because that is a big one for me. So within my samples, I have my sample packs folder. I have a series of subfolders. That's the author, the sample pack, and then I just have the word packs. So I'll give an example of one of my favorite producers, Umru. I have that for everything. The author sort of depends on who made it, whether it's an individual producer, like a company, or a splice pack. I put all of Umru's sample packs, except I make sure they follow the conventions that I want them to, which is generally pack title, and then the number. I think it's good to change all of these because some people name them really dumb stuff. So this would be like sound cache. I have like this same setup for my own packs as well. So like any of the samples that I make go into like Sleepy Cat pack 1, Max Tromp pack 2, whatever. But following this structure for everything keeps all your samples organized, easy to use, easy to find. I think the most important thing is being able to find them wherever you need to. So if you take that SSD to someone else's house and you don't have all of the organization that you did in Ableton or whatever, you can still find them because they're in the same location. The next part of this I want to do is my own music projects. I sort of just added the numbers depending on how often I use them. Those can be used the same as the design folders where you have this sort of chronological scheme going on, but exports I usually use for anything I'm sending to people, finals for distro. So I'm just gonna talk about my projects folder because it's essentially the same as the sets one. In there, I follow my sort of standard year. And then within that folder, I'll have a bunch of folders or project files depending on how big the project is. But when I do iterations, I'll add a 01 to the file name and 02, 03, etc. So you end up with all of the iterations of the song in there. Also in this folder, sometimes I'll include like an IO folder, and that's for files that people send me, whether they're vocals, samples, anything. So those all go like into the sample folder. So if you ever have to back it up, it's easy to just copy all of the files. Last one I want to touch on, which is really close to me, is how I organize my DJ music. In my DJ music folder, I have my year. Within my year folder, I have all the months. So these are all of the folders. And then within each of those, I'll do genre, month, year. So that looks something like this. So if it's like dubstep, I'll do dubstep, January, 2021. And then I'll just put all of my MP3s and waves into these subfolders here. And each month has their respective folders. There's a really important reason that I do this, and that is because I've sort of been between like Windows, OS X, and because of that as well, everyone uses different DJ software. So I mainly use Serato, but when I want to use Rekordbox, Traktor, it's like they all have different file systems, so it's a mess. So by having them sorted like this and getting used to where the songs are and how to find them in this scheme, you'll be able to use them on any software. And the benefit as well, get this. I mainly use iTunes to sort my DJ music because it links in with all of the softwares. So with Rekordbox and Serato, the iTunes integration is exactly the same. So I'll use playlist folders and smart playlists that sort of mirror this scheme. And when I import all of my music into iTunes, I'll set the genre as one of these things. So I've got a bunch of songs where the genre is House January 2021. And then in your smart playlist, in the January playlist folder that is called Dubstep January 2021, you set it to search for genres that are this one, and they'll all just appear in that playlist. So if you like break your file system or you move to a new iTunes, which I've done before, you just set up this smart playlist and it all comes together. So thanks for bearing with me through this video. I know it's a lot. Let me know in the comments what you think of it, if you have any recommendations to make it better. Hopefully it changes someone's life. So that's all for today. Peace.